News Radio WHAM 1180 welcomes you to The Seniors Rock Show, presented by the law firm of Clark Feshkin. The Seniors Rock Show, a lively weekly discussion, shedding a bright light on aging with fun, entertainment, and important info for all adults. Join us with your comments or questions. Call or text 222-1180 or 1-800-295-1180. Now, from the News Radio WHAM 1180 studios in downtown Rochester, here's your host, Joanna Palvino.
Well, hello and welcome to the Seniors Rock Show. I'm so happy you're joining us today because it is a special day. It is Veterans Day and we are celebrating it and we have a special guest. I'm Joanna, your host, and for the next hour, I'll be here with you and with my co-host, estate planning attorney and partner with the law firm of Clark Feshkin. Mr. Mike Robinson is here today. So good to see you, Mike. Uh-oh, you're muted.
All right, there we are. Happy Saturday.
Yeah.
Happy
so I was Saturday. Saying, yeah, good to see you.
Yeah, good to be here. And I'm looking forward to the show. It's going to be a good one today.
Absolutely. And I'm going to start the show actually with a thank you to one of our listeners who's also a local author. His name is Jay Diedrich. And Jay connected us with today's guest, and we are very glad that he did. Worked out perfectly. And what better way, we thought, to honor our veterans than to have one as a guest today on Veterans Day. And, you know, Veterans Day, everybody knows, is a day to honor active and former U.S. service members. And today we're going to be joined by Angelica Angel Pilato, who was born right here in Rochester, New York, and she is an RIT alum, and that was just the beginning. Believe me, what a story, and it took me a while to call it down to be able to fit it into an hour, but we're going to fill you in on some really important things that she's done, and I'll tell you the first thing. Angel went on, after leaving Rochester, to become the first woman Air Force officer to manage an officer's club on a fighter pilot base during the Vietnam War. She's here to tell us that story and how it led her to write her memoir, Angel's Truck Stop, A Woman's Love, Laughter, and Loss During the Vietnam War. Angel's had a very interesting life of service, and we're honored, very honored to have her on the show today. And Angel Pilato will join us shortly. Before we do that, let's check in again with our resident estate planning attorney, partner with the law firm of Clark Feshkin, Mike Robinson. We've been missing you, and I'm thinking you might have some thoughts today on Veterans Day, Mike. What do you think?
Yeah, well, I do have some thoughts, Joanna. You know, I've always got thoughts on something. So, I'd like to, if I may, step on my soapbox for a moment and talk about one of my pet peeves. And, you know, I'm glad we celebrate Veterans Day. It is important to recognize the contributions and sacrifices of veterans and their families. But when it comes to supporting our veterans, simply putting a day on the calendar or saying thank you for your service doesn't cut it. You know, these men and women and their families have made significant personal and financial sacrifices on our behalf. And we as a country really need to do better in supporting them. You know, I just was recently reading some survey results. Every year, at least, well, for the last 13 years, I guess, the Blue Star Families Organization, in collaboration with Syracuse University, conducts a survey that tracks issues faced by veteran and active duty military families. And among the more recent findings, more than half of veteran spouses surveyed report financial stress, and nearly half of unmarried veterans report financial stress. The survey indicates that military families face greater food insecurity than civilian families overall, and greater overall financial stress than civilian families. Both veterans and active duty military express concerns about access to health care for themselves and their families, as well as the ability to afford health care when it is available. Nearly half of the veterans surveyed said that their transition to civilian life was difficult or very difficult. And among the factors impacting that difficulty is the challenge for veterans in getting hired after they leave active service. Another alarming statistic It is estimated that each night there are approximately 40,000 veterans facing homelessness on the streets. And I think we're all aware of the mental health issues and substance use disorder issues that veterans face. So we need to be doing more to support these men and women. And frankly, the way that we do that, Joanna, is by supporting and electing candidates that speak to these issues, who promote this kind of support, and actively vote for legislation that is going to provide the support. And conversely, that we don't support and vote for people who block access to these services, who are not promoting the benefits that our veterans deserve, and some of whom, you know, openly espouse and advocate for authoritarianism and autocracy, which are exactly the kinds of things that so many of our veterans fought against. So I just wanted to put that out there. Happy Veterans Day to my son, who is a veteran, and so many other people, friends I have who are veterans. But it's a pet peeve of mine. You know, we always say thank you for your service, but let's put our votes where our mouth is.
Wow. Sobering stats, Mike. Thank you for bringing that to the table. And, you know, you have to look at both sides of the coin. We want to say these things on this special day, like you said, but it's important to remember to support our veterans every single day. And it reminds me, recently, we were having a conversation. You know, we have lots of the kids and the grandkids and the extended families, and everyone's trying to figure out how we get together on Thanksgiving Day. And I said, you know what? There's 365 days of the year. I'd love to see any day you can make it. So here's the thing. Electing officials who will do the things that we need them to do to protect our veterans and to make sure that they're getting taken care of is crucial. So thanks for bringing that up. And thank you for reminding us that our veterans need support every single day.
There you go. Now to estate planning. How's that for a pivot?
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. So, interestingly, just this past week, Thursday, I think it was, IRS released its annual revenue procedure that makes inflation adjustments for the coming year to certain tax items. And a lot of it, of course, is income tax related, but specifically relevant to estate planning. The estate tax exclusion amount for decedents dying in 2024 is increased. It's up. It was this year, it's $12.92 million. Next year, it's going to be $13.61 million. So I know, Joanna, that's a relief for you to know that. And of course, what the estate tax exclusion is, that's the amount that we can pass upon our death without having to pay any estate taxes. The annual gift tax exclusion, also indexed for inflation, that's going up from $17,000 this year to $18,000 for 2024. And for married couples who have a spouse who is not a U.S. citizen, you know, for U.S. citizen spouses, they can make unlimited gifts to each other, unlimited in value. There's no tax implications. But for a non-citizen spouse, there are limitations. And so for 2024, the first $185,000 of gifts to a non-citizen spouse are ignored and not included in the amount of taxable gifts for that year.
Well, Well, John, did you hear that? Anyway, yeah, thanks for filling us in on the latest, as you always do on estate planning, Mike, because those things are important. And, you know, it's something that you need to keep up with and you need to talk to an estate planning attorney about to know what's new, right? I mean, you're the person who's checking these things constantly. Maybe Deanne's helping you, but I know that you're always up to date on the latest.
Well, and you're right. I mean, that's kind of, it's what we do for a living. So it's really our job to pay attention to that stuff. And that's one of the things I always tell our clients is that's what part of what we're doing for you is we're going to keep you up to date and let you know if there's any changes that might impact your planning. And, you know, as you've heard me say so many times, one of the reasons people's estate plans don't work is they're not being kept up to date.
Right.
On the changes that might impact them and their families. So, yeah, important to get this information out.
And change happens so often, especially today. It's like rapid change, it feels like lately. And so thanks for reminding us that we should check on these things. We should be sure that an attorney knows what's happening and that our things are being protected. And thank you for that, Mike. Angel Pilato has a story that you won't want to miss, folks. Stay tuned to Seniors Rock Radio, and she's going to be up with us next on News Radio WHAM 1180.
Took me 4 days to hitchhike from Saginaw. I've come to look for America. Laughing on the bus.
Welcome back to Seniors Rock Radio, and our guest today is Dr. Lieutenant Colonel Angelica Pilato. Dr. Pilato simply goes by Angel, or if you're her family, you'll know her as the favorite aunt, who recently returned to Rochester after decades away to be closer to her family. Angel is a private pilot and a Paul Harris Fellow. She holds life memberships in the Red River Valley Fighter Pilots Association, also known as the River Rats, as well as Veterans of Foreign Wars, American Legion, and Vietnam Veterans of America. And of all these, Angel Pilato says her most prized title is favorite aunt status with her nieces and nephews.
Wow, Mike, that is pretty impressive. And because it's Veterans Day, we wanted to know more about Angel's role as a woman in the U.S. Air Force during the 60s. I was so attracted to find out about that. So let's see. We've asked her to take us back today to 1971 when she arrived in Thailand at one of the largest Air Force fighter bases in Southeast Asia, where out of 3.5 million veterans who served during the 11-year Vietnam War, she became the only woman to manage an officer's club on a fighter base and live to write a memoir about it. So welcome to Seniors Rock Radio, and thank you for your service, Angel Pilato.
Thank you so much for having me today. And I want to thank Mike personally for giving all those kudos and reminders to the listening audience about supporting people who support our veterans.
Absolutely.
So thank you very much. Now, you wanted me to take you back to 1971, and believe it or not, I can still remember it, okay? It's as clear as day to me. I got off the plane at Udorn, and it was blasting hot, humid. And I had a greeting committee that was there waiting for me because they had never had a woman boss that was going to run that officers club. And they wanted to see what she looked like.
First of all,
was she ugly and fat? And how would she be as a boss? So at any rate, and then the Thai employees came, and of course the major who was going to be my boss, and also the man who had been the club officer was there. And because the commander was concerned that I was going to be the manager, he had asked that gentleman, to stay an extra 30 days to see, to kind of let me know the ropes. I'd already been a club manager for 4.5 years, but they weren't sure. So they had me stay. They had him stay an extra 30 days to kind of make sure that I wouldn't mess things up. Okay, so that was my greeting at the airbase at the time.
Interesting. I've got to ask you, 52 years ago, what was it like being a woman in the military at that time?
Well, let me tell you this. I was clueless when I went in. The recruiter was cute, and he gave me a great deal, you know.
Wait a minute. I know. I read something about you left because you thought you were going to a warmer climate. Tell us about that.
Yes. Well, my car, when I joined in 1967, my car was under 8 feet of snow in Michigan. And I said, what am I doing here? I don't need to stay here. And I had gotten these little pamphlets about how you could serve in the military and do these special jobs. And I was a food management major. So, you know, I wanted to find out. So I went and checked it out. And I went to the Navy, and the Navy wanted me to know how to swim. And I didn't know how to swim because my mother didn't think girls needed to know how to swim. And so I asked him, key point, do you let the girls on the ships? And he says, oh, no, we don't have to. So I didn't know why I needed to know how to swim. Okay. So I went to the Air Force recruiter, told him what happened. And he said, well, that's the Navy for you. That's the Navy for you.
Wow.
Yeah, we got jobs for you. So then he decided to tell me what I would be doing. And then he'd send me to Texas. It was 70 degrees. And like I said, he was cute. So I signed up.
Makes sense to me. Hey, we have to go to break, but we will be back in a minute. And we're talking to Angelica or Angel Pilato, and she's going to be right back after the news. So please stay there. You're going to love the rest of the story. Welcome back. Nice choice on the tunes there, Pam. And now we're going to continue with Angel Pilato. We've been listening to her story. And of course, we have more questions, Angel. And I'm going to start with this one. It's important. How did you get the assignment as the first woman Air Force officer to manage an officers club in Southeast Asia that was full of men? Please do tell us.
Well, first of all, I asked the recruiter when he was giving me all this information, I said, could I run one of those officers clubs? Because he had taken a bunch of recruits to an officers club. And I said, that's it. I can do that with my background. And he said, oh, yeah, you can do that. No problem. Well, at the time, I did not realize that there wasn't any other woman doing that, nor did I realize that there was any big deal about it until I got to my first base. And the guy said, the boss said, they said they were sending me an assistant, but they didn't say it was going to be a girl. So that kind of started my welcome to the Air Force, you know. Then after they got used to me after about 4 years, I volunteered to go to Southeast Asia. And again, I didn't realize I was the only one, but then I found out that I was. And so that's how I got it.
Wow. Interesting. That's wild. Yeah.
Angel, what led you to decide to write your memoir, Angel's Truck Stop?
Well, I used to tell funny stories about the fighter pilots and their little antics at dinner parties. And, you know, how nude gals came out of cardboard cakes and sat on the general's lap and everybody would laugh. And and they said, Angel, you should write a book. You're so funny. Well, look, anybody who gets C in English should not write a book. They should leave this to the professionals, okay? But people kept bugging me about it, and then I decided to start putting some notes down, and because my memory was very vivid for that year, and I started putting notes down, and then the stories that came out were not the funny ones.
Mm. Wow. Now, I'm wondering, how did you, first of all, how did you get the name Angel's Truck Stop? And then go back to the book and tell us about how long it took you to write it.
Yes. Well, the name Angel's Truck Stop, my brother said, you can't have that title. Everybody thinks you're going to be selling hamburgers. And I said, no. I got that name because the guys, after they would have a successful flight, and they would, you know, shoot down enemy aircraft, they'd come over to the officers club to celebrate and drink and carry on. But before they would do that, they would drive their truck up the front stairs of the officers club and park it in the lobby.
Oh,
and of course,
I couldn't say
you're going to ruin the rug. I just said, put a tarp under the truck and leave it because, you know, and so because there was more of them than there was of me, I wasn't going to fight it. And so finally they said, well, you know, Angel's been such a good sport. We're going to nickname the officers club Angel's Truck Stop. And that's how I got the name.
I love it. How long did it take you to write the book?
Well, let's put it this way. I started it in 1990 and I finished in 2011. Wow. But I wasn't working on it that entire time. I was working on it in spits and starts. Fits and starts, right. Is that how you say it? And then, you know, I had little notes and papers and typed things on dot matrix print, you know. And then I finally decided, I had a friend kept telling me, you got to put this together. And then that's how I did it.
Gotcha. Hey, real quick before we go, what did you get out of writing the book personally?
Well, I think what I got out of it is a sense of satisfaction, of course, that I finally finished it. But I also realized that writing can heal your soul. And it also can heal other people's soul if they read it and can identify with things that happened. And then, of course, I think that's the big thing.
Wow. Please tell the listeners how they can get the book, please, Angel, and anything else you want to say before we have to go.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me on today. It's always wonderful to talk about veterans. There's a lot of heroes in my book, Angel's Truck Stop, and you just go to angelstruckstop.com. And
on the boats and on the planes, they're coming to America. Never looking back again. They're coming to America.
Oh. Well, welcome back to Seniors Rock Radio. We're so glad that you were here with us today. We hope you'll come back again next week. And we're going to have a great show, Mike. I have a different co-host next week. We'll miss you, but we have Mike Bonnity, another Mike, and he is better known as the Getaway Guy. And he does a lot of fun things. He talks about places to go in our local area and places to visit and great places to eat and all kinds of travel tips. So he'll be sitting in the co-host chair next week. And we'll also have some guests from the Village at Nudity. What? Excuse me. The Village at Unity and Care Patrol will be here as well. And Julie always has great information for everybody. And then in 2 weeks, I must mention this because I've been waiting for this show. We're going to have a recycling show. And I have asked the folks from Monroe County to come in and tell us, please, what can we and what should we not recycle? Because I am more confused every week when it comes to recycling and getting rid of that stuff.
It is confusing. And yeah, so I'm looking forward to hearing that too.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, the Village at Nudity, is that's probably a higher monthly fee than the other place, right?
Well, it may be less because there's no tone. I can't believe I said that. Anyway, excuse that. Anyway, we do have a good time here. And speaking of good times and speaking of important things coming up, I wanted to mention before I forget that on Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, November 15th, is the only day, so check this out, put it on your calendar, to go to Aging with Options Resource Fair. It's being put on by the GRAPE organization. It will be at the JCC on Edgewood Avenue, and it's only from 11 till 1 on Wednesday. Now, it's important that you check it out because you'll find all kinds of resources there, and you can actually talk to someone in person. You don't have to call and be put on hold or have someone call you back. You can go there. It's a free event. Talk directly to the reps from home care agencies, from senior living communities, from moving assistants and all these different kinds of things that'll help you in the different stages of aging for you or your loved ones. So that's a great opportunity. Get together with your folks and go on down to the JCC, put together again by the GRAPE organization. A lot of our sponsors of the show are also members, and you'll see them there. So you get to meet them in person. I think that's cool too. Don't miss it. It's one day only again, this Wednesday, 11:15, JCC, 11 till 1. You can get more info at grapeelder.org. That's GRAPELDER.org. Mike, I see you. You look like you're thinking over there. What's happening?
I'm always thinking here, Joanna. So
I know you are. And thank you again for saying all those wonderful things about the veterans and to remind us of those things that are important. Not just, you know, we want to toot the horn and beat the drum and all that kind of stuff. But boy, bringing it back to reality and reminding folks about what's really real is so wonderful. Thank you.
You are welcome. And I also wanted to put in a plug in just a few minutes. The Section 5 AA football championship game kicks off University Prep at McQuaid, and two wow. very good programs, two very well-coached teams. If you like local sports and you can get out there, I think you're going to see a good game. So, and congratulations to both teams to making it to the playoffs.
Absolutely. And is that all you have to say?
One more thing. Be well and be kind.
I thought you were going to forget that. So anyway, we don't forget that we salute veterans every day, and we want to thank them for protecting us and our families in this great nation that we call home. And you know what? We know veterans rock. And of course, we'll remind you, like we do every week, that seniors rock.